Shalom, and welcome to Via Havta Yisrael, a Hebrew phrase which means, you shall love Israel. We hope you'll stay with us for the next 30 minutes as our teacher, Dr. Baruch, shares his expository teaching from the Bible. Dr. Baruch is the senior lecturer at the Zera Avraham Institute based in Israel. Although all courses are taught in Hebrew at the Institute, Dr. Baruch is pleased to share this weekly address in English. To find out more about our work in Israel, please visit us on the web at loveisrael.org. That's one word, loveisrael.org. Now, here's Baruch with today's lesson.
Do you have the right perspective on life? That is, are you seeing things from God's perspective? Are you able to discern what is truly of significance and what is of deceit, falsehood? See, too many people, and I mean too many believers, they are emphasizing things that God isn't interested in, that He's not about, that do not reflect His character or objectives. So we desperately need to have discernment. And Paul, when he came in contact with the risen Savior, that is Messiah Yeshua, he had such a change in perspective. And that change in perspective gave him joy, gave him assurance, gave him a true zeal for life. And he realized something. It was only through faith in Messiah that he could truly behave in a way that was pleasing to God. And how can we summarize that way? Well, very simply, we can say it, V'ahavta l'rayecha kamocha. Love your neighbor as yourself. And when you do that, you know what you're going to find? You are going to find great joy and contentment and satisfaction in your life. Now, here's the problem today. Instead of wanting to be a blessing to others, an influence in their life, and pay attention to this. When I say an influence in their life, I'm speaking about a godly, a holy, a righteous influence in someone's life, not manipulating them to do what you want to do, want for them to do, but utilizing biblical truth, sharing that, influencing them, that they might walk obediently with God. And we're going to see, as we study today and in the weeks to come, it's only when we do that, that the outcome of that, God will place within us a true joy, a feeling of satisfaction, one that truly meets your inward desires. You may not realize that, you may not be pursuing that, but that is what your innermost being, that soul, truly desires. And it's not something that you can consume and find. It's not something that you can manufacture yourself. It is something that comes from God. It is an outcome from Him supernaturally, spiritually, in a person's life. And the outcome is a true and lasting joy. And here's the sad point. So many people desire that. We all have that need. We were created for that. But most people are pursuing it in a wrong way. And therefore, they don't have what they're looking for, and their life is frustrating. Their life is going in a wrong direction, and they just keep pursuing things, thinking, well, if this doesn't satisfy, this will. If I just get more of this, if I just have more of that, then I'm going to be happy. No, you're not. Not until you live your life with the proper perspective, having become a new creation in Messiah Yeshua. Take out your Bible and look with me again. We're in the midst of our study of the epistle to the Philippians, and we're in chapter 3. And Paul has just talked about this transformation that has happened to him. How what was important to him, what he was pursuing, what he had achieved, all of this he saw as a loss. And the word here can be, well, in modern Hebrew, and I realize this is Greek, but the modern Hebrew word that really, really summarizes what it is nezek. What is that? Damage. And here's the sad truth. Many people are pursuing the things that they believe is going to make them happy, content, give them that inner feeling of tranquility, when in actuality, those things, that lifestyle, is really damaging them. Well, what does Paul say? Let's pick up where we left off last week. Look, if you would, to Philippians chapter 3 and verse 8. Paul says here, "Moreover, also I consider all these things that he had, all this pedigree, these things that gave him prestige, these things that other people looked up and said, oh, I wish I could be like Paul, having risen up within Judaism to a place of prominence, having lived a life of discipline." Discipline's good, but they need to be disciplined based upon biblical truth, not religious doctrine of man. Religious doctrine and dogma of man will put you in bondage. And Paul was, because he was doing these things in order to find approval, the approval of man, rather than living in a way that was pleasing to God. And therefore, Paul says, "Moreover, also I consider all these things to be a loss." Why? As we said last week, on account of the surpassing. Now, this is a way, not only does it surpass, but it continues on. It's not something that breaks through and ends and over, but it's continually, this word surpassing. It says basically, it's a word to have over, to possess it over. It has to do with a constant achieving of something that doesn't wear out. He says that surpassing knowledge of Messiah Yeshua. And here it is, not just that he exists, not just what he did, but recognizing him and living under the truth that he is the Lord of our life. Paul says, the surpassing knowledge of Messiah Yeshua, knowing him how? As my Lord. Now, why is that important? Well, it's important because the lordship of Messiah means that he is ruling your life. He is guiding, he is taking you where he wants you to be. And in the midst of that journey, you're doing his objectives. And when we are his instrument, what does Paul see? Paul sees great satisfaction. Let me ask you, are you truly living a life that's satisfying you? One that is rooted in joy, a joy, as we'll talk about in a few weeks, that's not based upon circumstances, but your identity as a follower of Messiah. That we can have joy and contentment and peace in our life despite what we're going through. It's not dependent upon our circumstances, the things that we're encountering, but who we are in Messiah. So Paul says the surpassing knowledge of Messiah Yeshua and knowing him as my Lord. He says through which all things, not just most or some, but all things, he speaks in bold detail. All things, he says, have become to me a loss. Now, this phrase for being a loss is in the passive. What does that mean? It means that the more you serve Messiah, the more that you walk in obedience to him, having been saved by his grace, these things of the world, you are going to what? Realize their insignificance. All these things, material things, they all are going to come to an end. And why would we want to build our life, invest in things that one day they're going to have no value whatsoever? When is that day? Well, there's two possibilities. For most, that possibility, or for most, it's the first possibility. That is, that we're going to die. And we're going to see those things that we emphasized, that we worked for, that we sweated for, all those things have no eternal significance. They're not tied to the kingdom of God. And we're going to bemoan because we're going to feel deceived, and we were. We were deceived by the enemy because we pursued, we worked, we strove for these things that had no lasting significance. They were empty through and through. Even if we received it, they only satisfied for a fleeting moment. So Paul says, these things, because I know him, and now I'm seeing what it means to follow him, obey him. All these things, he says, became lost to me. They had no more significance. In fact, he says, look at the end of verse 8. He says, I consider them to be, and he uses a strong word, rubbish, garbage. Why? Well, the idea is this. Now, we don't buy garbage. We don't want garbage. Garbage is the outcome of something after we've used it, that we've taken everything from, and it's what we throw out after they have been consumed. So we dispose of these things. And what Paul is saying is this. Many of the things that we are pursuing in our life, well, we're just going to consume and throw out. We don't want that. We want that which is eternal, that which endures, that which continues on. And those are kingdom things. And that's why Paul is speaking in the terms that he is. So let me ask you, what are you striving for? Are you striving for those things that eventually they'll be garbage and you'll just throw out? I mean, I remember not too long ago, I was driving and we went by this home and it was having what commonly is referred to a garage sale. And all the people were there buying things up. You know what it is? When you think about it, it is those things which people purchase. You know what? They really never wanted them. They don't have use for them. They have worn out. They don't have space for them. And now they're just trying to get rid of them. To get a little bit of money, they can do the same thing over again. How futile. No, invest in the things that have long-term, eternal implications. What does Messiah say? He says, you know, strive for those things that don't wear out, that moths don't eat, that don't rust away, but treasures in the kingdom of God. That's what Paul has learned. That is his new perspective. So he says, I consider all these other things to be garbage. In order that, and here's the key, I have to have a change in perspective. If I don't change my perspective, I'm not going to, because the word here is word hina in Greek, which is in order to. It speaks about something, and it's only when that is being done, being understood, being received, then there's an outcome. Without this understanding, this action, this behavior, the outcome won't be a reality. So Paul's saying something. It is only when we have that right perspective, a heavenly point of view, that we see things for what they truly are, then and only then are we going to turn and be able to do what? Notice what he says. In order that Messiah that I might gain. Verse 9. And what does he desire? Here's what he desires. Verse 9. That I might also be found in him, not having my own righteousness, which is from the law. Now, why does he say my own righteousness? What his own life can produce, what his own behavior can bring about. Now, the word here is righteousness, but this is the righteousness that is defined by religious dogma, religious doctrine, the righteousness that the Pharisees spoke of. And Paul is saying that didn't satisfy. In fact, when I came in contact with Messiah, all these things that were so dear and important and pursued by the rest of the Pharisees, Paul says, I counted all of this as a loss, all of this as garbage, for knowing Messiah as Lord, that I might, look again at verse 9, that I might be found, and this is a term that Paul uses over and over, in him, in him, in him. And what does that mean? In his will, experiencing his presence in my life. So let me ask you, are you being guided by the Holy Spirit? Do you have a personal experience with Messiah? And here's what it comes down to. If you have truly accepted the gospel and you are a recipient because of that receiving of the gospel, you will be a recipient of the Holy Spirit. You can't deny knowing Messiah. You experiencing Him. You are going to have the Holy Spirit directing you, counseling you, moving you into truth. You can't deny that. And therefore, Paul is saying this is what brought satisfaction to him. This is what changed his life. So we read that I might be found in Him, not having a righteousness of my own from the law, but rather, he says, but the, and the implication is, the righteousness through faith of Messiah. And that's what it says, the faith of Messiah. The faith that He imparted, the faith that He revealed. And it's only faith that brings this about, this change in perspective. The faith of Messiah. And it says, through God there is righteousness. That is, the faith that leads to the righteousness, not of man, not of the Pharisees, but he says here, but the faith that brings about the righteousness of God, a godly righteousness. What does that mean? It means a righteousness that is pleasing to Him, one that He imparts to you. And because He imparts it to you by faith, it is going to be manifested in you, in your actions, in your thoughts, in the person that you become. You are transformed. And that's what Paul was saying. This radical change that happened in his life when he began to live differently, not based upon the religious teachings of man, but upon spiritual revelation that did what? That caused him to be joyful, satisfied, and confident. Not confident in him, but confident in Messiah. Entering into this eternal covenantal relationship with God. Look now to verse 10. And knowing Him and also the power of His resurrection. Now, we're getting into those things that are so important. Knowing Messiah as Lord. Secondly, experiencing, and this is what he's talking about here, experiencing the power of the resurrection. What does that mean? The power of the resurrection, when Messiah was risen from the dead, that's what God the Father did. When Messiah was raised from the dead, what did he have? A new life. Why was that? Well, very simply. Remember what it says, and we learn in the previous chapter, Philippians chapter 2. Messiah emptied himself, taking the form of a servant, serving even unto death, and he put on human flesh, clothed humanity. Becoming fully man, he never lost his identity as the Son of God, but he became fully man. But when he rose from the dead, he rose in a new way. What does that mean? Well, he could go through buildings. Remember, the doors were locked. He came in. He was in one place and he was immediately someplace else. And that's that new body. What does the scripture say? Well, he's the firstborn from the dead. And that's saying what he has in that body, that resurrected body, we're going to have that same thing when we are resurrected from the dead. And in that new body, you know what we're going to be able to do? Perfectly serve God. And that's what Paul is saying here. Look at the text once more. He says, to know Him, and don't miss the relationship between these two things. Knowing Him and the power. Knowing Him gives you power, a resurrected power. What does that mean? Well, when we receive our new bodies, we will not be able to sin. In this body, we will. And what Paul is teaching is this. Here's his utmost desire. And I hope your utmost desire. And that is to live a sinless life. To be living today with this power, this resurrection power that reflects resurrection, whenever we hear that term, we should think of the kingdom. So Paul, when he says, I want to know him and his power of the resurrection, he says, I want to live how I'm going to in this new body, in the kingdom of God. I want to live that out today. That is his desire. That is what he is all about. And keep reading. He says, and also the fellowship. I want to experience intimacy with God. Notice what it says. And the fellowship of his suffering. Now, as we live, and here's the key, all these things go together. You know him and you have the potential to live a kingdom life. When you live a kingdom life that's so different than the ways of the world, what is it going to bring about? It is going to bring about suffering, persecution. The world's going to rise up against you. And what Paul is revealing here is that he desires that because it brings about fellowship with him. See, it's a growth. We begin this passage, go back to verse 10. He says, to know him. Now, we want to know him better and better and better and better. When you fall in love, my own relationship with my wife, it's just not that, yes, I know her, but constantly I'm discovering more about her. And the more you love, the more you'll want to know more and more, to the point that there is utter transparency. Nothing is hidden from one's spouse. You trust them. You love them. And the same way, Paul, he is wanting to be truly transparent, and he wants to know the fullness of the knowledge of Messiah. He wants to know him better and better. And he talks about one of the ways that we do this is through, notice what he says, verse 10, the fellowship of his suffering. When we're willing to suffer for our faith, it brings about a change. What change? Just keep reading. Look now to verse 10 at the end where he says, and being conformed to his death. What does that mean? When I know Messiah, I have fellowship with him, I'm going to be conformed to the likeness of his death. What does that mean? I'm willing to lay down everything for him. What did Messiah do? He did perfectly the will of the Father, not thinking about any of himself, but he laid it all down ultimately when he prayed in that Garden of Gethsemane, not my will, but thy will be done. And that led him directly to the cross and everything that went along with the cross. And what did that bring about? It brought about victory. So it's only when we live an obedient life are we going to experience the victory that God wants us to. And that's exactly what Paul is revealing here, that we might know him, have that faith of Messiah, that we might be of the righteousness of God, that we will know the power of his resurrection, the fellowship of his suffering, denying ourselves, being persecuted. So the point that we'll be conformed to his death. And he says, this is my desire, to be fully given over to the purposes and the will of God. Looks now to verse 11 at the end. He says, and if somehow that I might obtain the resurrection of the dead. Now, what does he mean by that? Well, he's going to be resurrected from the dead. Every believer is, but he's emphasizing. He's just underscoring what he's already built. And what's that? When one is resurrected from the dead, their life of sin is over. Resurrection brings perfection, spiritual perfection. It brings about a new body of righteousness in our life. And that's what Paul wants to obtain right now. He wants to live as though he's in that resurrected body. He wants to live totally in obedience to the purposes of God. And he says that not that I have already obtained it, but that's his desire. Look at verse 12. Not that already I've received it or have already been made perfect. He's saying, I'm not perfect, but that's what I desire. That's what I want to demonstrate to others. And that's what I am pursuing. Again, if also that I might lay hold of that which also I was laid hold of by Messiah. What's he talking about? The purpose of God. We need to realize something. Messiah saved you. He took hold of you through this new covenant, through the gospel. He took hold of you for a purpose. And what Paul is saying is this, very simple. I want to fulfill the purpose. I want to receive the things that Messiah took hold of me in order that I might become, that I might receive, that I might do, that I might experience. What is Paul saying in very clear and loud terms? Paul is saying, I want to embrace the will of God for my life. The reason why Messiah took hold of me, he saved me. There is a purpose for that. And I want to fulfill that purpose. Do you ever think about that? Do you ever pray about that? God, you saved me. And there must be a purpose for my life. That you have brought me into an eternal relationship with you. And now, whether I have a day left, or a year, or a decade, or 50 years, whatever it might be, I want to lay hold of those things that you have taken hold of me when you saved me, that I might experience them, that I might do them, that I might fulfill those objectives that you have for my life. That's what spiritual maturity is all about. And that's what Paul is committed to. So again, you have to ask yourself, I need to ask myself, are we committed to those things? Are those the things that we are pursuing? See, most of the time, this is what happened. We have quite a different spiritual approach. We believe, oh, God is on my side. These are the things I want. And God, now that I have received that gospel, I have access to this living God, this powerful God, to make these things that I want, that I desire, that I dream about, that they would become a reality in my life. See, when you have a faith like that, you are exactly where the enemy wants you to be. Because you're going to be blinded by your desire rather than receiving the revelation for his desire from your life. And you're going to be frustrated and empty and powerless to have the life that Paul wants you to.
Well, we hope you will benefit from today's message and share it with others. Please plan to join us each week at this time and on this channel for our broadcast of loveisrael.org. Again, to find out more about us, please visit our website, loveisrael.org. There you will find articles and numerous other lectures by Baruch. These teachings are in video form. You may download them or watch them in streaming video. Until next week, may the Lord bless you in our Messiah Yeshua, that is, Jesus, as you walk with Him. Shalom from Israel.